Today we have to study, brothers and sisters, two places from the Quran, that is first 11 ayat of Surat Al-Mu'minun and ayat 19 to 35 from Surah Al-Ma'arij, Juz 29. And the first one, Surat Al-Mu'minun, is Juz 18. So we start. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون والذين هم لأماناتهم وأهدهم راعون والذين هم على صلواتهم يحافظون أولئك هم الوارثون الذين يرثون الفردوس هم فيها خالدون وقال عز وجل إن الإنسان خلق هلوعا إذا مسه الشر جزوعا وإذا مسه الخير منوعا إلا المصلين الذين هم على صلاتهم دائمون والذين في أموالهم حق معلوم للسائل والمحروم والذين يصدقون بيوم الدين والذين هم من عذاب ربهم مشفقون إن عذاب ربهم غير مأمون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون والذين هم لأماناتهم وأهدهم راعون والذين هم بشهاداتهم قائمون والذين هم على صلاتهم يحافظون أولئك في جنات مكرمون. First we have the translation of these ayat. First the 11 ayat from Surah Al-Mu'minun. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. قد أفلح المؤمنون. Indeed the successful ones are the believers. Indeed the believers succeed. Who believers? الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who are very humble in their prayer. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. And those who always keep away from love, from vain, from useless activities. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ. And they perform zakat. Zakat has two meanings. One is purification and the other is the regular charity that we make on annual basis. Then وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ. And they guard their privates. Don't let them get exposed. Illa ala azwajihim, except to their wives, aw ma malakat aymanuhum, or to their maid slaves. Fa innahum ghayru malumin, for that they are not blameworthy. Faman ibtagha wara dhalika fa ulaika humul adun, But those who seek sexual pleasure beyond that, these are the ones who exceed limits. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ, and those who keep their pledges and their covenants. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ, and they guard, take care of their prayers. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْوَارِثُونَ, such are the heirs. الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسِ, who would inherit the Firdaus, the paradise, هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ, they would live therein forever. Then, ayat from Surah Al-Ma'arij 19-35. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ حَلُوًا. Indeed, man is created short-tempered. إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوًا. Whenever a calamity befalls him, he cries, becomes impatient. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. But when he is blessed with a fortune, he becomes stingy. إِلَّا الْمُصَلِّينَ, except those who pray. الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ, they pray consistently on permanent basis. وَالَّذِينَ فِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ مَعْلُومٌ, and in their properties there is a certain share, a certain right. لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ, for the beggar and the have not. وَالَّذِينَ يُصَدِّقُونَ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ, and they testify the day of judgment. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ عَذَابِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ, they are always afraid about the punishment of their Lord, torment of their Lord. إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّهِمْ غَيْرُ مَأْمُونَ, indeed their Lord's punishment is not something which is not taken care, which is not considered, which you always think immune of. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِمْ أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ غَيْرُ مَلُومِينَ فَمَنِ ابْتَغَى وَرَاءَ ذَٰلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْعَادُونَ. These three ayat are duplicated here, so I'm not translating them again. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ. This also is being replicated here, same as in Surah Al-Mu'minun. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِشَهَادَاتِهِمْ قَائِمُونَ, and they stand by their testimonies. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ, and they always take care, always guard their prayer. أُولَٰئِكَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ مُكْرَمُونَ, such are the ones who would enter the paradise, would be in paradise, in Jannah, with due respect. The heading of these two lessons from the Quran is character building, the basis of character building. If we just look back on our previous lessons, we studied Iman in detail. The genesis of Iman, synthesis of Iman, and then in the course of that, we studied the nature of human being. And then we had two lessons from the Quran. One complete lesson on the Day of Judgment, and that was from Surah Al-Qiyamah. And then we had a lesson from Surah Al-Taghabun, which had the description of Iman, all three. Iman Billah, belief in Allah, belief in the Prophethood, in messengers, and belief in the hereafter. And then there was an invitation. فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَالنُّورِ الَّذِي أَنزَلْنَا. If you agree with all this, then believe in Allah, His messengers, and His messengers, and in the light which has been sent down with Him, that is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then there were the rewards of Iman. First, the rewards in the hereafter. Those who believe, they would enter paradise forever. And those who refuse to believe, they will be thrown to hell forever. And there were worldly rewards of Iman. And that is, if you believe in Allah, that nothing happens without Allah's permission. All is happening, it is happening with His permission. It's all His decisions which are in action. Allah's decisions are being complied. So He is my Lord, I am His slave, He is very kind to me, and He will never do injustice with me, and He will never do a wrong to me. All that He decides for me is excellent for me. So there is a peace of mind. This is the worldly reward of Iman. As far as the worldly achievements in the of the believers is concerned, in this world, a believer in general will be deprived because he considers this is lawful and this is not lawful. So he goes after this and doesn't go after that. So his economics, his worldly gains are automatically reduced. Not only that, a believer may be persecuted too, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions were badly persecuted. But they would all be rewarded in the hereafter. But as far as this Iman is concerned, and to believe in Allah and to trust Allah, tawakkul, that is the worldly reward of Iman. And everyone who really believes in Allah does have a peace of mind which the billionaires may not have. And then there was a nice, pleasing nature of a believer, especially towards his household. He is not harsh, he is not unjust, unfair, but he is kind to his household. Three instructions were given to believing men. Indeed, some of your wives and children are enemies to you. They may drag you to hell. So just be careful. But don't be harsh to them. By nature, they are weak. Allah Almighty, for a special reason, has made the nature. The children, we very well understand, they are not mature, so they are emotional. We give them allowance, whereas we assume that wives, they are grown up, they are sensible, and they should well behave. But by nature, they have certain weaknesses. One of them is that when they open their mouth to criticize, to blame, they may go on for hours. Number two, they are thankless by nature, just like children. So Allah Almighty says, وَإِن تَعْفُوا وَتَصْفَحُوا وَتَغْفِرُوا. If you ignore, turn a blind eye and forgive them. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah Almighty is also forgiving, merciful. Now we are starting with the righteous acts described by the Quran. Today is our first lesson on ayat from Suratul Muminun and Suratul Ma'arij. And these are the basis of the character building of a Muslim. So we start with the lesson. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qad aflahal mu'minun. Indeed, believers have succeeded. The believers have achieved. The heading is the achievement of believers, success of believers. And then the characteristics of believers. How they are successful. The first character they have is الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who are humble in their prayer. You know, in prayer, we pray five times. We should have attention. We should understand. We should be regular, consistent. But a very important feature in our prayer should be that we should be down to earth. We should be humble. Prayer teaches us to bend in front of Allah and then to prostrate before Him to prove that we are not arrogant. We don't consider in front of Allah that we are also something. We say we are nothing. Oh Allah, you are our Lord. We are your slaves. You have full control on us. We don't have any. You dictate us, drive us, move us, whereas we can't. So this feeling must be in our heart when we are praying. And let me say, it should be the real spirit of the prayer. In these two places of the Quran, if we see, in comparison, in this Surah Al-Mubarakah, Allah Ta'ala has described two characters of the believers regarding prayer. First character is, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. They are humble in their prayer. But at the end of these 11 ayat, Allah Almighty says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. That they guard their prayers. It's in plural, salawat. That is, one should be so much careful about his prayer that he doesn't miss any. May it be the Fajr prayer, where we have to get away from the bed, we have to leave the sleep, and we have to come to say, Labbaik, O Allah, I am here. Or it may be the Isha prayer, especially in the West, in the summer. Isha prayers is sometime late, 11 o'clock, 11:30. So you have to be watchful about your prayer. But in Surah Al-Ma'arij, there are two things mentioned about the prayer. One is, Allazina hum ala salawatihim daimun. And they are consistent in their prayer. They are regular. To pray only on Eid or only to offer the Jummah prayer or whenever it's easy, pray, or otherwise don't pray. This is not actually prayer. So these four characters should go side by side. Number one, humbleness, humility. Then consistency. And then in Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah Almighty says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. But in Surah Al-Ma'arij, it is, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. They don't miss any prayer. Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib and Isha. Then when Allah Almighty says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ, that they don't lose, they don't miss any important feature of the prayer. Now sometimes we are very lazy in prayer and we don't perform sajda properly. Sometimes we don't perform ruku properly. Sometimes we don't perform qoma and jalsa properly. We are coming up and then coming down. So we lose certain arkan of the prayer. So in Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah Almighty is emphasizing that we guard our prayers. No prayer should be missed. And in Surah Al-Ma'arij is that we don't miss the prayer. That is the Salat itself, that all the arkan, sitting, bowing, prostrating, and the intervals between two sajdas and the interval between ruku and sajda, it should be properly performed. Another important feature to be noted is that in Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah Almighty is describing Salat as an independent feature. But in Surah Al-Ma'arij, it's very interesting that Allah Almighty is starting with the weakness of man. Innal insana khuliqa halua. Indeed, man is created short-tempered. How? Iza massahu sharru jazua. When he is blessed with a calamity, a misfortune, he cries. Oh, what happened? Oh, I lost. This is short-temperedness. He cries. He complains. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. But when he is blessed with a fortune, he becomes stingy. He holds it, lest he should make it charity. He lets others to share. That is the short-tempered nature of man. But then, instead of saying, إِلَّا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, except the believers, Allah Almighty says, إِلَّا الْمُصَلِّينَ. It appears that the mu'mineen and musalleen have the same meanings. They don't have the same meanings. But iman is the basic ideology of a man, of a Muslim. But salat is the main feature of a Muslim. Especially those living in the West and in winter. You offer your dhuhr at 1 o'clock, quarter past 1, and then at 2:30 you offer your asr, and before 4 o'clock you have to offer your maghrib. So you are coming to the mosque and going back to the mosque, going back from the mosque, then coming to the mosque and going back to the mosque. So you can be known as a musalli, the one who prays again and again and again and again, or you can be named as a believer. So a believer and musalli appear to be one and the same. So perhaps this is Allah Almighty is saying that in Surah Al-Mu'minun, the heading is Qad Aflaha Al-Mu'minun. But the heading of Surah Al-Ma'arij is Al-Musalleen, Illa Al-Musalleen, except those who pray. And then about prayer, as I already said, Allazina Hum Ala Salatihim Daimun, they are consistent in their prayer. Actually, the prayer is the most prominent feature of a Muslim. 5-time prayers. You know, there are characters, there are features which Muslims share with the others. A righteous Christian, a righteous Hindu may not cheat anyone like the Muslim. A Muslim should not cheat anyone, and a Hindu and a Christian and a Jew should not cheat anyone. The Muslim should be nice to others. So should non-Muslims be nice to others? But the sign of a Muslim is not honesty. The sign of a Muslim is not charity. The sign of a Muslim is not truthfulness. The sign of a Muslim is not humbleness. A believer will be known to be a believer by 5-time prayers. Especially those brothers who live in the West, in the societies, mixed societies. Anyone who goes to the prayer, goes to the mosque 5 times to pray, he will be known to the whole community that this is a Muslim. But anyone from us who is not regular in his prayers and doesn't go to the mosque to pray 5 times, his features would tell that he is Asian. His features will indicate that he is from Indian subcontinent. But it would not be clear whether he is a Hindu or a Muslim or a Buddha. The sign of a Muslim is without any doubt 5 times prayer. And as we know, 5-time prayers is fard on Muslims, men and women. But pray 5 times with Jamaat is wajib on Muslim men. Then we move further. In Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah Almighty is saying, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. There is no such ayah in Surah Al-Ma'arij. And we have 3 ayat in Surah Al-Ma'arij, which we don't find here. These 3 ayat are, وَالَّذِينَ يُصَدِّقُونَ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ, and those who testify the day of judgment, the day of reward. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ عَذَابِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ, and they always, وَالَّذِينَ يُصَدِّقُونَ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ عَذَابِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ, and they are always fearful of the doom, the torment, the punishment of their Lord. Inna azaba rabbihim ghayru mamoon. Indeed, the punishment of their Lord, the torment of their Lord is not something which someone should feel immune that he is not going to have the punishment. It's a general view of the secular minded people that Allah Almighty is very kind, always inclined to forgive, and he's going to forgive. It's just the sheikhs, the maulvis, the imam or the masajid, they intimidate Muslims of the punishment of hell. All the Muslims will be forgiven. Allah Almighty is making clear that وَالَّذِينَ يُصَدِّقُونَ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ, the successful ones, those who will go to the paradise, they testify the day of judgment, and not only they verbally testify, they are always fearful about the punishment of their Lord. Why? Because the punishment of their Lord is not something which they should not be concerned about, or which they should feel immune that they are not going to have that punishment. The Prophet ﷺ was leading the eclipse prayer, and during the prayer he swiftly moved forward, and after some time he swiftly moved back. After the prayer, the companions asked Rasulullah ﷺ, is there any change in the way of praying, or it was something special? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that when he was praying, the veil of paradise was lifted and a bunch of grapes was in front of me, and inadvertently I moved to that bunch of grapes. But after some time, the veil of hell was taken away and a flame came to me and I swiftly turned back. If Allah's messenger was fearful of the day of judgment, he used to dread the hellfire, and he used to have persuasion of the paradise and its blessings. How can we assume that we are certainly going to enter paradise and enjoy all the blessings of paradise? While Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the persuasion of paradise and had the fear of hell. Another important thing is that these ayat are not the ayat of Ma'arij, Suratul Ma'arij, وَالَّذِينَ يُصَدِّقُونَ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّهِمْ غَيْرُ مَأْمُونٍ. These ayat we don't find in Suratul Mu'minun. But instead of these ayat, we find an ayat there, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. They always keep away. They always avoid the vain activities, useless activities. Actually, if one believes in the paradise, believes in the hereafter, and fears the day of judgment, he would never waste his time in vain activity. The vain activity, you are watching a cricket match for 5 days. You are playing cards day and night, playing chess, having no idea for how many hours you have been playing. No. One who is playing physically, cricket, hockey, football, badminton, table tennis, where he is getting the benefit of his body. But where he is not getting any benefit of the body and he is just wasting time, this is because though he believes, but he doesn't remember that one day he'll be raised to life again after death and he'll be brought before his Lord to produce his account. If we remember this every moment, we are not going to waste even a second of our life, because as Allah Almighty says that Allah khalaqa al-mauta wal hayata liyabluwakum ayyukum ahsanu amala, Suratul Mulk, that Allah created life and death to test you which one of you performs righteously, rightly, beautifully. So if we are in examination, if we are under trial, our time is very precious and we should not lose our time. As while sitting in the examination hall, only a foolish one would waste his time. He will avail each and every minute or second of the time to write more and more, check again and again that he doesn't miss any important point or he doesn't write anything wrong. So, وَالَّذِينَ يُصَدِّقُونَ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ عَذَابِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّهِمْ غَيْرُ مَأْمُونَ and thereby وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. So, the next we come to the ayat of Surat Al-Mu'minun. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ and they perform the act of zakat. As I said, by translation, zakat means द रेगुलर एनुअल चैरिटी दैट मुस्लिम्स डू, और इट मीन्स इट मे बी ट्रांसलेटेड एज प्योरिफिकेशन. सो इफ यू ट्रांसलेट एज प्योरिफिकेशन, इट वुड मीन दैट दे ऑलवेज आर केयरफुल अबाउट देयर सेल्फ प्योरिफिकेशन. दे थिंक दैट दे शुड नॉट एक्ट रॉन्गली, दे शुड नॉट परफॉर्म रॉन्गली, एंड दे शुड कीप देयर सेल्फ, देयर हार्ट नीट एंड क्लीन. आई डोंट हैव टू स्पीक मच ऑन दिस एज वी हैव स्टडीड दिस इन सूरह नूर. सो द अदर मीनिंग्स, वल्लज़ीना हुम लिज़्ज़कात फ़ाइलून, दे परफॉर्म ज़कात, दैट इज दे आर वेरी रेगुलर इन पेइंग ज़कात ऑन एनुअल बेसिस. देयर इज नो सच आया इन सूरह अल-मआरिज, बट इन सूरह अल-मआरिज वी हैव अनदर आया, टू आयात रादर, वल्लज़ीना फी अमवालिहिम हक़्क़ुम मालूम. यू नो इन ज़कात आल्सो इट्स नॉट जस्ट charity, you calculate and decide that, oh, this is not my right, this is someone else's right, this is the right of the poor people that I have to pay to them. But in Surah Al-Ma'arij, Allah Almighty is saying, وَالَّذِينَ فِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ مَعْلُومٌ, same thing, they, in their properties, there is a certain share, certain right, certain due, for whom? لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ, for the beggar, the one who asks for, and mahroom, the have not, the poor one. A very important point which I want to make here is that we, as I said, those who have gone to school, university, we do have the virus of secularism in our mind and our thinking is certainly polluted with secularism, and we have different objections, concerns about paying to the beggars. Oh, these are professionals, they are all taught, well to do, this, that. But Allah Almighty is saying that in their properties there is a certain share, certain due for the sail, the beggar. We say, okay, if beggar is deserving, you must pay him, you must do charity to him. But if he doesn't deserve, we shouldn't pay him. But Allah Almighty is saying that he is deserving. Haq means right. So Allah Almighty is saying, Sail has a right in your property, and the have not too has a right in your property. That means Sail, the beggar, is also deserving, and the mahroom is also deserving. Mostly people are very upset when I say this, that the Sail, the beggar, has a right. He deserves. But I want to point out that we are all guilty. We have done a lot of wrong things in our life, and we are doing. It's only the messengers, the prophets, they were masoom, having no sin in their life. But we, other than prophets, and we people living in 2021, we are making a loss or a lot of trespasses. When we raise our hands for prayer, for supplication, we say, Allahumma inni zulamtu nafsi zulman kathira. Oh my Lord, oh Allah, I have wronged to myself a lot. La yaghfiru dhunuba illa anta. No one except you forgives. Faghfirli maghfiratan min indik. So grant me forgiveness from your grace. Warhamni, and treat me mercifully. Innaka anta arhamur rahimin. Indeed, you are the most merciful. On the day of judgment, if I urge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me. And if he says you don't deserve, and the justice is, if I've done wrong, I must be punished. If I have committed a sin, I must be punished. Then why I'm asking for forgiveness? A sinner, a wrongdoer, who has done wrong things, sins, trespasses, he doesn't deserve to be punished. But we ask Allah to forgive us. But whom Allah says they are, they have the right, they're deserving, we say they don't have the right, so we should be very careful. I pray. And this is very, very interesting to note, that mostly we have the feeling that we want to be righteous people, noble people, but we aren't able to. A famous poet of Urdu, Ghalib, says, "Janta hoon, sawab-e-taat o zohd par tabiyat idhar nahi aati. I know the rewards of righteousness and God-fearing attitude, but I don't find any inclination for these things." To get inclined to righteousness and to get inclined to charity, it's very important that you pay someone whom you don't want to pay, but for Allah's sake. I don't think he is deserving, but my Lord says he is deserving. His decision is the prime decision. His decision should be complied, not my decision. I give up mine and I comply his decision, Allah will be very happy. And inshallah, we would feel inclined towards righteousness and towards our deen. Allah Almighty in both Suratul Muminun and Suratul Ma'arij is repeating same three ayat without any difference at all. Even without a difference of dot. Allah Almighty says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ, and they always guard, their privates. That means they keep them watertight, airtight, and don't let their privates be exposed to, except إِلَّا عَلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِمْ, except to their wives, أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُهُمْ, and to the maid slaves whom their right hands possess. This is the idiom for the slaves. فَإِنَّهُمْ غَيْرُ مَلُومِينَ, for that only they are not blameworthy. To understand, this is a subject very hard to understand, especially for the sisters. For this reason, we must understand one thing very clearly, and that is that man and woman are not identical. Allah Almighty has created man with the nature, and a list has been provided in Surah Al-Imran, ayah number 14, that what has been made attractive to man, top of the list is women. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ, and then come the sons. But for women, as we studied in Surah Hajj, their weak point is their children. She is never unattentive to feed her child. And whenever there is a woman in close contact of a man, especially at his workplace, and even more when he is relaxed at home. At workplace, he is formal. It may not be that dangerous for him.
but it's not free of danger even there. But at home, whenever there is a woman in close contact of a man, that may be the sister of his wife, her cousin, his cousin, the wife of his friend, daughter of his friend. If not today, tomorrow he will walk to her. He will advance to her. I remember in year 2001 when I was Imam at Finchley Mosque, London, and I delivered a dars of these ayat, and behind the curtain there were sisters too, and one of the sisters who was a convert from Christianity, she was also listening to my talk, and her husband was a good friend of mine, and mostly between Maghrib and Isha he used to stay with me, and we had to used to have a cup of tea and gossip together. In the evening when he came, he was smiling, and he said, my wife was very furious, and she asked me, when Suleiman was born and my sister was here, did you have any persuasion for her? And smilingly he said to me, I had to lie to her. So it's the nature of man, which women, our sisters, must understand. They should pay attention to their husband. They themselves should serve him. It's very interesting that if man is ill-natured, harsh, he has a lesser danger than a nice man who treats nicely, who behaves nicely, who is kind to anyone who is close to him. When man will be kind, nice, well-mannered, and if a maid makes a mistake, he doesn't shout at her, the maid will be more inclined to him. And then, as I said earlier, a line is crossed. And when a line is crossed, man doesn't know. One doesn't know when he strips out of clothes. So, since the maid slaves, not the maids, remember, we are talking about the maid slaves who are not free, who are just your property. You own them, you provide them food, you provide them clothing, and a young woman has another need too. It's your duty to provide her that need too. Number one. Number two, since the real fact is on ground that whenever there will be a woman in close contact to me, especially serving me other than my wife or my sister, my mother, my daughter, whom I'm not allowed to marry, غَيْرُ مَحْرَمْ, I'm certainly going to have an inclination towards her. So, this is the case of maid slaves, not the maids who are free women. Allah Almighty has, because He created me, He knows my nature, and accordingly He has given the commands. So, He has allowed me to have sex with her. The question raised is, you should marry her. The question is, marriage contract is a contract, nikah is between a free man and a free woman. The woman has a choice to say, no, I don't want to marry you. I don't want to marry him. But does a slave have a choice? No, a slave doesn't have a choice. But the main thing is that we got to understand the nature of man, the weak point of man. If you understand this, you'll be rather sympathetic with man instead of blaming him. Another important thing is that the most pious, the most righteous man ever born, can be born, is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had 10 wives, but he had one maid slave too. To tell us that this also is allowed. This is not blameworthy. If we blame that anyone who keeps a maid slave and has sex with her, oh, he's bad. He's blameworthy. Then we would blame Allah's Messenger too. And Allah's Messenger, according to our belief, doesn't commit any sin, doesn't do anything wrong. We must remember that Sayyida Maria Qibtiya, radiallahu anha, she was gifted to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam by her father when the messages were sent to different rulers. And her father gave a respect to the messenger of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in return, he sent gifts. And two of his daughters also were gifted to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them was Maria Qibtiya radiallahu anha. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the other maid slaves who came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered them belief. Come to believe, be a Muslim. And they accepted Islam, they became Muslim. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam set them free. And with their free choice, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married them, with the exception of Sayyida Maria Qibtiya, who continued to be the slave and the slave of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then we come to the other ayat of the surah. Here Allah Almighty says we should complete this. فَمَنِ ابْتَغَى وَرَاءَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْعَادُونَ. Whoever seeks beyond this, such are the ones who are transgressors, who exceed the limits. In the old age, the parents, the teachers, they used to make sure that the child, the boy, is very cautious about her privates. But now, these things are not told to the children. Children are not warned about this. The mothers assume that since we have told children that this is bad, they won't do. It's absolutely wrong. To leave a sin, it's not sufficient to know that it's a sin. The emotions, the sentiments, the inclinations, they all should be considered. Then, in these two places, Allah Almighty is talking about the pledges and the covenants. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَأَحْدِهِمْ رَعُونَ. And they always take care of their pledges and their commitments. Only one ayah is left, and that is وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِشَهَادَاتِهِمْ قَائِمُونَ. And they stand by their testimonies. To stand by the testimony, it's also a very important feature of a Muslim and a righteous man. So Allah Almighty is also mentioning this in Surah Al-Ma'arij. But in Suratul Muminun, Allah Almighty is not mentioning that feature of the righteous Muslims. Perhaps because the last ayah before that is the last ayah of Suratul Hajj, is on the subject of Shahada, the testimony. And that testimony is that the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's duty is to prosecute, to testify against people that I have conveyed the message to them. Now it's their fault that they didn't comply. And it's the duty of the Muslims on behalf of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that they can testify on the day of judgment in the court of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala that they conveyed the message to the people. Now if they didn't comply, they didn't believe, it was their fault. So with that, we complete our lesson. I pray to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, He includes me and you all into the Mumineen, into the Musalleen, who have all these good features. Akhru Dawana, and Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Rasulullah.